We move on to our next session, which is a slightly deviant than our other sessions. First, we'll have a presentation, which will be followed up with a panel discussion, which will eventually be followed up with a Q&A with the audience. Ms. Sheela, Shankar, who is the head of customer engagement at HeyMath, will give the presentation, and she'll introduce you to the panelists and the panel discussion itself.
I'm always a little nervous when I'm standing on this side of a room, also because my boss is sitting here. So I'm going to rely on you all to help me with an experiment. I hope I can count on your support. So here we go. I'm sure you're all carrying your mobile phones with you. So could I request you to just take out your mobile phones and go to this link. You can see the link. It's www.pigeonhole.at. You can open a browser. Request you to enable your 3G, your mobile data, please. And enter the passcode as PLPHeyMath, all in caps. And you click on cast the vote, cast my vote. And there are just four questions that we would like to know what you think. Your opinion counts. And rest assured, we are not going to track your name or your number or, you know, receive that. That's not going to happen. So be comfortable. Just help us with this poll. Are you able to go to the link? Yeah? Can you just have a quick show of hands? People are able to move to the link? Yeah? Some more participation, please. There are four questions. You can start, and then you can, after you finish a question, you can go to next. It shouldn't take you much time. Yeah, you're able to see the questions? Okay, all right. Now, let's take a look at the results. Tuitions after school are necessary for mathematics. Wow, disagree, strongly disagree. Is good, it's rare, it's going up. Fantastic. And we also have a few strongly agrees and okay. After school tuitions provide individual attention to students. Okay. Nice. So we have, oh, it's a close between the agree and the disagree. Nice. Tuitions help improve a student's performance in school tests. Okay, again, if you combine the disagree and the strongly agree with the strongly agree and the agree, I think it's going to be what? I think power or yeah. Okay. And parents choose tuitions as it serves like babysitting or a way to monitoring the child's study. No. Okay. Strongly agree. A lot of people agree that parents choose tuitions as it serves like babysitting or a way to monitoring the child's study. Right. Okay. So here's the thing. These are questions that we have been thinking about. We have been debating about these questions. And, you know, we just wanted to know what our friends here are thinking, and you know, what is going on today. So in the context of these results, I would now like to present our topic for the day, which is impactful use of technology to create a personalized learning path for every student. Now it's very important for us, this word, every student, is very, very important, because as you can see our tagline, Hey Math, because every student counts, because we believe that every student can do math. It's something that we very, very strongly believe. We are very passionate about it, and we know that every student can do this. And I can tell you this, in the toughest of learning environments in South Africa, we have proved that students can do well in math. And how have we done this? So a little background about HeyMath. HeyMath has been a pioneer in math solution, providing math solutions over the last 18 years. It's been a long journey for us. We have built a very, very strong expertise in the CBSE curriculum, as well as other curricula around the world. We have worked with leading CBSE schools, and our work involves and includes supporting the work of teachers by providing them with a range of different pedagogies, different digital resources, lesson plans, assessment resources, math lab activities, teacher professional development, teacher work attachments, and so on. And what we have been able to do is we have been able to help them create a very engaging math class, and also help students build a very strong foundation in mathematics. Now that is very, very key, to build a very strong foundation in mathematics. Not only are they building a strong foundation, they are also enhancing themselves. This is what we have been doing over the last 18 years. However, we have also found that even the best of teachers, even the one who's really committed, who's really passionate about teaching, is unable to find that time, the individual attention that a student requires. Because in a class typically of 30 to 40 students, you have, you know, there are students who are coming with different deficiency levels. It's not that they're all coming with the same deficiency. So someone might be good in fraction, someone is having problems with decimals, someone is having problems with simplifying. So it is, we are finding that teachers are really, you know, not able to give that really personalized attention to students. So what we thought was, how do we further support? What do we do to further extend our support to the teachers? And what we did was come up with a program called the Personalized Learning Program. Now, what we are trying to do here is see if technology can be used to make the learning process less tedious, but at the same time guarantee results. So like the previous presentation, my fellow speaker was talking about how, you know, children are addicted to mobile games. They don't say that I'm bored with, you know, playing video games, but when it comes to doing homework, they get, you know, they're not so interested. So what can we do? What can we do to, you know, marry something that will help them do this homework, do the, you know, be interested in doing the practice, but at the same time not make it so tedious and boring. At the same time, make sure that, you know, they are seeing the results. So we have the program for classes 5 to 10, and I'm going to just quickly run through how this works. Now, it has a few components. It starts with a diagnostic test for every topic in that particular grade, in that particular curriculum. So let's say we start with grade 6, for example. Then the student will first be assessed in all the topics and the subtopics. So we include question types in the subtopics relevant to that particular grade. Then once the student takes the diagnostic test, based on the test scores, we devise a personalized study plan for the student, because each student is different. Now, at this point, there are two things. One is to relearn the concept, and the other is to practice to improve. Now, no amount of practice without building some conceptual clarity is going to help. So if I keep practicing without understanding what is the underlying concept for that, it's not going to help. So there are two components in the study plan. One is to help students build the conceptual clarity and then also help with the mastery of the topics in which the students had difficulty. So as you can see, it is going to be a very different path for each student. So here is a further example of that. So this is a student, Deepika, from class 6, who is going to be working on number systems, whole numbers, understanding elementary shapes and integers. For, you know, lack of space, we've just shown you four topics, but the program includes all the topics in that particular grade. Now, the assessment, once the assessment begins, that is the diagnostic test, the student will get immediate results on how they have done in each topic. Now, you can see that here the student's grade is a C because the student has got only one out of the five questions correct, right? So how do we go from here? How do we, you know, help the student to move from C to a better grade? Now, this is where the personalized plan comes in, where we have recommendations for the students for both completing the practice to achieve mastery as well as the lessons. Now, when I talk about lessons, they are not just some, you know, video lessons. They are lessons that are really engaging in terms of the interactivity, the discovery, the visuals, the tools that we use, the pedagogy that we use, because as you all know, math, you know, could be abstract, you know, there are, so how do we make real life connections? How do we teach them that you're learning LCM because, you know, you can use it here, or you're learning circumference because this is how, you know, you find the circumference of the circle. So both the how and the why are taught in this, when we are recommending the lessons to them, so that they can go back to the basics and then move on to the mastery. After each customized practice, what you can see here is that the grade has improved, and you can see that in the first question, the student got it right in the first attempt itself. So in the second question, the first attempt the student is wrong, and we provide the fully worked out solution for the student to be able to see how to do that problem. So the student can go through the solution and then get to the problem. So we see all kinds of combinations, you know, when we are looking at the data, we see that, you know, students have sometimes got it in the first attempt, but sometimes they have, you know, tried two attempts, but eventually they get it in the final attempt and so on. So here, and it is possible that sometimes they don't get it at all, which means that they have to go back once again to the concept building lessons. Now imagine a student getting a report like this, where for every topic, the student is told what is his score in the diagnostic test and what is the score after intervention. So in this slide, what you are seeing is against each topic, there are the subtopics and the score for the pre-test, that is the diagnostic test, and after the diagnostic test, when the intervention was provided, how the score has improved. By the way, these are all real data that we have, you know, we have just taken a sample screenshot of a student report. And you can see that the red denotes that, you know, the score was less than 40%, but after intervention, it has moved, the band has moved to 40 to 75%, or in some cases, even greater than 75%. So imagine getting this report. Now, this is going to help the parents also know, where do I have to help the child with? You know, not just blindly say, okay, open your textbook and start doing exercise 12.1, all the 35 problems. The students will run away. They are not going to be doing that. So that is the reason why, if we are able to give them a plan and say that, you know, this is where your student, your child is facing difficulty, it helps them to then plan and prioritize their revision. Now, on the other hand, for the teachers, what we provide is a dashboard, very comprehensive dashboard, which tells them overall for the class, if these are the topics that you have been doing, what are the subtopics that are difficult, So we are able to see that, you know, these are the some of the subtopics that students are having difficulty in. Now this is available for every grade 5 to 9. They'll be able to see whatever topics that, you know, they have been doing, and then see the color code will tell them, you know, where they have to focus or where the teachers have to work on. Now we also did a pilot, you know, because it's something, you know, unless you have the data, unless you have the figures to prove, you never know whether your program is working or not. So we did a pilot in the months of May to July, and 36 CBSE schools participated in this pilot, and there were 14,541 students who participated in this program in grades 5 to 9, and these were the countries and locations from where we had students participating: Delhi, Singapore, Chennai, Malaysia, Bangalore, and Qatar. And what we found was that grade 5 and grade 8, interestingly, now we chose these two grades because in the light of talks about, you know, having the central government saying that, you know, states could conduct exams for grade 5 and grade 8 to help the students do better later, we thought these two grades would be good to find to figure out what are the problematic areas. So through the pilot, we were able to figure out that in these two topics, in grade 5, factors and multiples and measurement, these were some of the problem areas for a lot of students. And similarly, in grade 8, in mensuration and rational numbers, these were problem areas, which is really alarming, because these mensuration especially is something that they will need to use, and if they are not going to be able to, you know, fix this, then they are going to have problems in 9, 10, and if they are taking a science stream, in 11 and 12 for sure. So these are things that need to be fixed. But the good news is that we also saw that there is an increase in average performance by 35% for grade 5 students post the intervention, and by 40% for grade 8 students. I think that's fantastic, you know, considering that they were doing this for the first time and they diligently did the program. What we saw was that there was improvement. One big learning from our pilot was that when we were talking to the schools and the teachers and the students, they said, it'll be great if you could also align this to our school's calendar, which means that suppose I know that from October 12th, I have the school test, or I have my math school test covering topics, number systems, whole numbers, integers, elementary shapes. How is it that I can prepare before that test? So our, you know, a week or 10 days before the program, we could, you know, assign them the personalized learning program. They could take a diagnostic test. They could figure out where their weakness and strengths lie, and then move on to doing the practice. And this, we feel, will help them better. They feel that it will help them do better even in their school test. So if the school test schedule is known to us, we will be able to align the program to the topics in the school test schedule. Data is one thing, figures speak, but also, you know, it's nice when you hear from the students what they feel. So this is our, you know, very spontaneous reactions that we got from children as we spoke to them after the pilot was over. So I'm just going to share with you some very, very spontaneous reactions from children who participated in the pilot.
Mistake. They again asked me to do it. That is something which I liked about it. It gave opportunity to do it again and again.
I like how they gave you practices at the end of each part when you didn't score well. I thought it was very helpful.
You also had videos which helped me to learn. When I did some wrong, it showed me a video and I learned many things from that video.
So did it help you do the next test better?
Yeah.
Then understand how to use the evaluation from the entire.
So we come to the end of this. We also conducted this pilot in a school in Chennai, Vidya Mandir at Estancia. And we are really very fortunate and happy to have the founder principal of Vidya Mandir at Estancia, Ms. MAHESHWARI NATARAJAN, here with us to share her thoughts about the personalized learning program pilot. And that will be followed by a conversation between Ms. NIRMALA Shankaran, co-founder of HeyMath, and Ms. MAHESHWARI NATARAJAN. May I request you both to come on stage, please. As they're coming on stage, I would like to introduce Ms. MAHESHWARI NATARAJAN. She is the founder principal of Vidya Mandir School at the Estancia campus in Chennai. She began her career at Vidya Mandir Mylapore as a teacher 28 years ago, where she had helped establish the twinning collaborative program with Singapore schools and served as vice principal for 5 years. She has a postgraduate degree in psychology and education and has attended several education and education trainings here. She has spearheaded the school's work towards winning the prestigious International Schools Award from British Council. Among many recognitions that MAHESHWARI has received, the most revered one is from our late president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, who felicitated her on moving out from your comfort zone to establish a school in a rural area. I think that deserves a good round of applause. MAHESHWARI loves cats and spends most of her free time with her cats, Tashi and Bean. May I also take a few minutes to introduce Ms. NIRMALA Shankaran. She is one of the founders of HeyMath, a global leader in mathematics education with users in over 50 countries. She leads product design, innovation, and talent management at HeyMath. She is committed to building excellence in maths education by constantly synthesizing best practices from high-performing systems around the world, drawing insights from pedagogical research, and staying on top of the latest in educational technology. NIRMALA has an MBA from the Indian Institute of Management, Bangalore. Prior to that, she graduated from Delhi University's Sri Ram College of Commerce and stood first in the university. So here's your Delhi girl with Ms. MAHESHWARI NATARAJAN, and I hope you enjoy the discussion.
Coffee with Karan. So I'm closest to being Karan Johar, and you being the celebrity. Okay, so MAHESHWARI is actually supposed to be on leave very soon, so I'm really grateful that she decided to accept our invitation and come from Chennai last night. So you've been an educator for the last, an educational leader for the last 28 years. And you've seen the ecosystem through all the lenses of each of the players, whether it's a principal, teacher, parent, student, and also the CBSE board itself. So what in your opinion, in the context of this polling that we just recently did, what in your opinion is contributing to the staggering growth of the tuition market, the parallel school outside of the schooling system, and especially in mathematics? Why is there such a staggering rise in tuitions?
Good morning to all of you. Mathematics has not been my passion. I'm the daughter of a mathematics teacher who was branded as your Sharada teacher's daughter, and you don't know maths. That's how I was my first relationship with mathematics. And it is true that maths had a lot of tuition in the earlier days. Over the past 30 years, I've seen a change in this trend of where tuitions were a necessity because the child could not understand what was in the class, to today, where tuitions are a necessity because parents feel they are doing something wrong if they do not send their students to tuition classes, especially if the child is going to appear for IIT entrance or maybe the engineering colleges or whatever. So it definitely has become a parallel school. So much so that as a principal, I feel very upset and hurt when my child tells me I cannot stay back for the play practice today because I have to go to my tuition class. I'm sure many of you are in that situation where you might want to have your teachers do certain personal coaching with your students, and they say no, they've already paid for our tuition classes, so we cannot afford to miss. To the extent that they do not turn up to school on Saturdays when you have school on Saturdays. It is really a challenge for us today. So what was a necessity has now become an inevitability. thanks to the peer pressure, thanks to the changing mentality of the parents. I somewhere feel there is a bit of guilt involved from the parents' angle, where they feel that since they don't have time to sit with the children and teach them, or maybe they don't know, like in my case, so they feel that it is better that the child goes outside. But what I can assure you is that the child has other avenues of learning today which was not available 30 years ago. There was no personalized training program, there was no online classes for them to, there were no online classes for them to take help from. So it was a necessity at some point of time. Today it's become a fashion. It's definitely become a fashion. In fact, I had a poll among my 9th and 11th 12th students where we gave them only two questions. Are you going to tuition because you want to go or because you're forced to go? The answer was very clear. We are forced to go. They would rather have that extra half an hour playing in the school than go to their tuition classes.
So when does this disease begin? Is it in 5th grade, 4th grade? Because I do hear of kids even going in grade 2 and grade 3. But when, in the recent past, where do you see the anxiety really kicking in?
I think anxiety kicks in whenever they are asked to write an exam. In my school, we do not have exams till class 5. So I can see that it is directly related to the fact that we have to give them grades. And the minute we say there is a grading system for promotion to the next class, then the tuition teachers step in.
And the CBSE is now transitioning out of the CCE system and going back, reverting back to the traditional board exam system. And I hear that there is a very strong likelihood that even class 5 and class 8 will be tested from next year. ICSE has already moved in that direction. So what do you think is going to happen in terms of adapting the school system, especially the teachers' mindset and even the students' mindset? Because in the old system, I've heard people say that I didn't do well in the latter half because I forgot the first half. The first semester is over and done. So if you test me in the second semester about the first semester stuff, I can't do it. So what is going to happen in terms of adapting back to the board exam, which I think, do you think it's a good development to move away from CCE to?
To a great extent, yes, because CCE was not being followed in the way it should have been followed. Many of us know that CCE was just a set of grades under certain parameters, which we just did it because we have to fill in those rank cards. But the CCE, if taken genuinely, is definitely a multi-pronged approach which we could have done based on, let's say, Howard Gardner's multiple intelligences. If we are able to give various parameters, various activities to the children, then CCE could have been done in a better way. But now that the marks has come into the fore and the children have forgotten the one's portions, we are finding it difficult. But what we are trying to do in our school is ensure that every lesson from some portion of the year or the other is included for any test or exam. This is only class 6 upwards I'm talking about. Up to class 5, we generally keep revising. We go back to a particular lesson either through our project or through our activities or something. So we are trying to keep the child tuned down to the lessons taught in June, even in the month of, let's say, March or April.
So you had a 29-year career, of which 19 years was in a hardcore urban school in the heart of Chennai, Mylapore. And then now for the last 10 years, you've been the principal, founding principal of a rural school. Vidya Mandir is one of the earliest adopters of technology. They are, I think, the number two school in India who have integrated HeyMath into their curriculum. And they use the program very effectively, both in the classroom for teachers to engage kids in math, and they also use the after-school program for the students to do additional practice and also to catch up on learning gaps. So it's been like 14 years of use of technology, both in this rural school as well as in the urban school. What has been the journey so far? What has worked well? What can work better going forward? Would be great to hear from you.
Like dropping me in the middle of the deep blue ocean when I got shifted from the urban school to the rural school. See, I come from a background of teachers which, and we are in the heart of Chennai. Mylapore, if you're not aware, is the heart of Chennai where all the so-called traditions and cultures are there even today, to a great extent. From there, I got shifted to, of course, through my own will. I accepted the shift, and we went on to a rural area. At that point, it was a rural area. Today, it has become semi-urban. Not semi-rural, but semi-urban in these 10 years. 10 years ago, when I came in, I had 80% of first-generation learners. My Tamil was not the Tamil which these people were talking. My Tamil was a metropolitan Tamil. And the rural Tamil was pure Tamil. So I had to change everything, starting from my mind processes to my way of talking to suit these parents. And three, there was an absolute no-no regarding computers. The first thing that when I asked the parents, how many of you had, we had 267 children in the first year. One child had a computer at home. I used to call the parents and tell them, please invest in a computer, because that is going to be the tomorrow, and we would like to go in for computer savvy lessons. And they would say, "Illa madam, that will, you know, the children will get spoiled. They will watch videos which they shouldn't watch." So there, in their minds, computer was bad. So it took me almost 2 years to talk to the parents, and when that didn't happen, I started talking to the children. I used to call my children and tell them, what is your budget for Diwali dress and crackers? And they would give me an amount. I'll say, you save that up this year, tell your parents don't buy. Instead, I would like to have a computer on EMI. So today we have just one child who doesn't have a computer, and he just joined last year. Maybe when I go back, I'll have to start talking to him. So computers were introduced and the children were trained. We took some time to call the parents who were not tech savvy to come in and train them. We trained them, no fees of course. Our teachers fortunately were very, very cooperative. We trained them. And then today I have HeyMath in every classroom in my school, and it goes to every home. Every child has lessons after school keying in onto HeyMath. And it's given a marked improvement in their confidence level as well as in their mathematical abilities. No doubt we also continue with mental maths on a regular basis, but this has really shown us a lot of improvement.
So one of the things we as an organization want to do is, we really want to, do something about the tuitions market. We feel that, first of all, I don't think the quality of the tuitions is consistent across, you know, different teachers who provide this. Plus, it is almost like a parallel school where you're not getting the individual attention, even though you pay a lot of money. Plus, I hear the children come back extremely tired, and it also becomes a social hangout place because you're meeting kids from other schools. And so there are a lot of issues associated with this whole tuition thing. So we are looking at how we can use technology to really provide an alternative, high quality after school supplemental support at an individual level. I think Dr. Pant talked about individualized learning and machine learning and AI and all of those things. So we are actually, we have quite a lot of data which tells us how we can actually scaffold learning for children, particularly in mathematics, because everything builds upon everything else. So we are, like Sheela presented about the PLP program, Vidya Mandir Estancia is one of the 36 schools that took part in the pilot. And the children in that school for the kids going from grade 5 to grade 6 and from 8 to 9, which we think are very important transition years. The students took part in the pilot. And there were no teachers involved because it was during the summer holiday. So the kids had accounts on HeyMath and they went on their own and they went through the diagnostic test, went through the personalized study plan, and then last week we shared the report cards of each child with the principal. So what was the, were you satisfied with the outcomes? What went okay? You know, what were the parents' reactions, the teachers' reactions?
The children were really happy because they had they could do maths at their own pace. There was nobody telling them, you know, you have to finish in 40 minutes and submit, and there was no teacher correcting it. So that lack of individual supervision was very positive there, which was my biggest worry. And one and two, the parents were absolutely happy because they said, one, it was in the summer holidays, it kept them occupied. Somehow we felt that they were keeping in touch with their lessons. And one parent came up with a very, very interesting feedback, I would say. She said, you know, ma'am, I spent 2,000 rupees just on dropping my child and bringing my child back. I have to take a break from work, go drop her in the tuition class, and then pick her up. I don't have to do that anymore. That was, I thought maybe from her angle, 2000 was definitely a big amount, and more than that, the time was involved was there, and then the traffic in our area is pathetic. So a lot of things have been saved by this child sitting for half an hour in her own room doing her maths, doing her PLP program. In fact, now they have opened up the site for classes 5 to 9. We are having our maths exam for the first term exam on October 23rd. So they've already opened up the site and the children have taken their diagnostic tests, and we are hoping that more numbers will be involved this time. There were a few who said, you know, we have to go out of station. You will always have those numbers. But these children were quite excited about the whole thing.
One of the students actually told me that his grandfather told him that if you, you know, complete these many units, then I'll take you for a movie. And so he said, okay, the grandfather's rocking it.
Okay.
Just one last question before we end. I think we may be running out of time, right? So I think we are all experiencing a grand transition in the world in terms of seismic shifts in technology, in the way society itself is transforming, and demographics. So the child who's 10 years old today is going to enter the workforce in 2030, right? And you and I have talked about this before. So what are the types of skills and competencies that as educators we need to inculcate in these children so as to be able to thrive and face the challenges of what's coming? The future of work itself is changing. So what do you think are some of the competencies as an educator you feel that we need to be inculcating in them?
I strongly believe that technical skills and maybe even subject skills can be developed at any point of time. But the basic skill of having values for certain things, values for the older people, values for money, value for time, value for the self, I think that is where we need to concentrate. Children are aping the Western world, children are aping their peer group and saying, I want this, I want that. The kind of mobile that they want is just told to the parent. They just want an Android or an Apple or whatever, and the parents go out of the way to buy it for them. I think somewhere, I was brought up in a strict household which believed in values. So that kind of system has helped me today. I'm able to face my difficulties, I'm able to face my drawbacks, I'm able to face no for an answer, which many of our children are not able to do. They come to class, 20 of them planning, asking the teacher, thinking they would tell the teacher that we don't want a maths test today. And when she says no, they are not able to take it. They supersede her and go to the VP. That's how things work today. I think these are the values which we need to teach our children more than anything else.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more, because I think we are facing a deficit of trust in society in general, whether it's trust in government, trust in corporate sector, trust in media, or trust in schools, trust in democracy itself. So I think there is a significant trust deficit all around us. And I think these eternal values of integrity and honesty and empathy, I think they will never go out of fashion. So I'm completely in agreement with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, HeyMath, for this opportunity. Thank you.